here, and so is our good friend Anna Jackson. Now, who was the first to arrive on the island?
Well, I think we arrived, mother and my brother and I, 1947, and possibly 46. We'll go with 47. Mother says 47, she would know. And we moved here from Sarasota because mother secured a job teaching at Cortez School. And we moved into the home that the Dietrichs now live on Mangrove Avenue, right on the beach. Lived there for a number of years and then moved across the street from Rosa Church in the house that Kay Rosedale now lives in. Which originally was the Blackburn home. And then moved to White Avenue, which is where we lived until I got married in 53, and mother sold and left there in 1954 when she went to teach with the military. She went to teach at the University of Hawaii and then joined the military and taught abroad. So we were here in 47, we decided upon, right?
Now, Lucy, when you started teaching on the island, where was the school then? And how large was it?
Oh, it was very small. And we had a deep sand playground. And we had all separate rooms, and most of them were in little boxes, wooden, one grade in each box. There were only one grade in the front.
Combination.
Great. Is that where the Island Community Center is now?
No.
Yes.
Oh,
yes. Where the youth center is now,
oh,
community
yes.
center. That's where the school.
Right.
And for a good many years,
that
same building was the community center, and then they added on to that. It's all gone.
Wasn't that just two rooms?
Two rooms.
Just two rooms, yeah.
Fourth grade, and Helen Roberts had the other. And they were large rooms.
Serena Phelps was the principal.
How many students about?
All together, dear.
100?
It was about, no.
About, I don't think 100.
No. I think she done good, about 6 or 7 at one time.
70.
There was quite a few when mother.
And then when she came, there were 100.
And we had a bad accident on that. There you go around. You all helped push it around, and then you jumped up the holes in the sand playground. And Denny Bates fell off and broke the skull of his head, and blood flowed, and we couldn't find his parents. And Lena had him in the car running all over Bradenton looking for him.
There's no doctor on the island.
But he went
to a doctor.
That was a half a day at least. Go to the doctor.
It was a life or death situation.
That was before Dr. Easy.
Oh yeah.
Yes.
I want to tell something that many children do not have the advantage of. When we moved into the new school in the spring, we moved from that old place. It was really a rickety. We had steps in the old place. We had steps going up. 5 or 6 steps going up because we were on, what do you call those wooden
stilts?
Stilts. Every classroom was on a stilt except the main building. And Betty Blackburn had the first, and somebody had the second, third. And I had fourth. I had part third and fourth. Helen Roberts had fourth and fifth. And Lena had sixth. And her room was the office. But then, after we moved down to that glorious brand new school, we dare not touch the walls on the walkway. Our playground had butternut trees, and we had a bag string, a marvelous bag string. It was a potato sack. And we had a solid, what would you put in a potato to sit on?
Probably rags.
Potatoes.
No, not potatoes.
You probably had rags in it.
I think rags, yeah, and they hard. Well, the children would climb up on these big branches, and they'd sit on this old potato sack and let go. And they would swing way out 15 feet and back and forth. And it was a marvelous contraption. It kept them tired the rest of the day.
You didn't have to worry about school.
And then we all had turns. We could take our class down to the beach and shell for science. And we did a lot of things right there.
Tell them about the lunchroom, how all the parents...
We had a wonderful PTA, just wonderful. Bunny Bates was the best, what would you say, best?
President.
President. And we had mothers represented from all different rooms working in the kitchen, and they loved it. Oh, they could have a good time there peeling potatoes and everything. And we saved quite a bit of money.
Now, would they just help? Because it seems to me Wanda Miller was there even then.
Oh, Wanda Miller directed the whole lunchroom.
Okay, so she was employed by the school board. And
ask me anything, because that makes it clearer.
I just remember her spoiling my children.
Oh, when they had a birthday, Wanda would always have a candle. Mm-hmm. What are you looking at?
Squirrel.
Daryl had her shower at her wedding. She had her wedding shower there in the big dining room. And she insisted on getting married before the school ended, so mother was in a dizzy.
Well, you were out of school.
Mother still had another week of school. John's mother was, she made the curtains for the teacher's room or something. Mother. Yes.
Teacher's room. They never had a nice teacher's room. And his mother decorated the whole thing. But the parents were a real help. What
That's
else?
Wonderful. So, now, Anna, when did you arrive?
I came here in about 47. Johnny and his parents were here, I think, between 1935 and 1938.
Oh. And they were in the building?
The building. Maintenance, Jackson and Honey. Maintenance and construction.
And they settled in Holmes Beach?
That was it, where we're at now.
And what is the story about the house that you and Johnny moved into?
On the house, that house was in a storm down in Bradenham Beach. They tied it to a palm tree to keep it from washing out. And they had bets going, and whoever could move that house or get that house moved, I think they could have it for $1,000, something like that. Had that house moved up there, because they were full of sand. And it took, I don't know how they got up there. I wasn't around.
On land or water?
No, they wound up on land. Up there. And that house was there until 1980. Until it was torn down through there.
And then did Johnny open his plumbing business? Or?
Johnny had the plumbing business. He phased into that in 1961. Because we had moved to Miami for him to get his license.
But he worked for Yearly for years prior to that.
Oh, and everybody knew him, you know, as working for John Yearly over in Cortez. Harry Moeller was the first plumber out with Aunt Maria. And did Shugart come in after Johnny?
He was after John.
Okay, then Johnny would have been the next plumber, then Shugart.
Now, what are some of the other things Johnny did back then?
Oh, he ran the Braden Laundry. He owned that.
He used to pick up our laundry. Yeah, I didn't really know Johnny then.
And then he used to pick up the St. Petersburg Times at the airport, which used to be Effie's Bar. Was the main building there at that. And that's where the photographers come over, and then that's where they had the airfield. That's where they played the donkey races, and also that's where all the main bigwigs gathered when they made the Estrellas movie.
Oh, and we're talking about the airfield and Holmes Beach. That's right where the Holmes Beach City Hall is.
Yeah.
People might not realize that.
I think the library's on the end of that thing now, right?
The library would be then, because Effie's Bars was the first building we came to.
Do you remember the time the airplane came in and didn't quite make it and landed in the canal?
Right there in front of the picture window where everybody was eating at Peter and ours.
It was quite a show.
Yes.
And Johnny Bandit won there in Martin's Propel, the first start.
In the canal?
No, but at the airfield. At the end of his flight. His mother never knew it, 2 years later.
And John, now did you tell us about your family?
I moved down here with my dad, mother and sisters. My dad had arthritis real bad, and I wasn't going to stay here. I was just going to help him get some apartments built, and then I was going back to New Jersey. Had my job back there waiting for me. But we came down with a dump truck, and I started hauling shell and fill out to the beach, and then started meeting some girls, and so I stayed here. Got married to this gal over here, and had 4 wonderful children. Now 5 grandchildren, and never lived anywhere else in Florida but on Anna Maria Island.
Do y'all remember any bad storms that hit the island, and what did the residents do?
Nothing really real bad. The storms we had
was mostly
back when I was in high school, there was mostly just beach erosion on the Gulf side. We didn't have the canals dug in like we have now, where they would overflow and the streets would overflow. Everybody made a big party out of it, everybody going out and sandbagging. And
everybody looked at it.
The community center, which at that time was the building which the Players is now in, would have hot coffee and hot soup and come in there and dry off, and if you wanted to spend the night, you could spend the night. They had army cots laid up across the chairs. Mother never allowed me to do that. I always had to go home at night. But we never evacuated, and I don't remember any bad storms until 1960 when Hurricane Donna came, and which was rather eerie because the canals went dry. You know, the water was all out of the canals, and you could almost walk without getting wet all the way out to the city pier. The tide had gone out that far, which made you a little bit concerned. You know, when this water comes back, it's going to come back on one big rush. But they actually got hit in town harder than we did out here.
Well, we lost some houses in that storm on the Gulf.
On the Gulf, yeah. But it crossed the state down around Fort Myers in Arcadia. I laugh because Liz Moss, who, I guess her twin boys, Jimmy and Eddie, must have been about 2 years old. She was going to evacuate the island. She was going to leave. She went down around Arcadia somewhere to her, I think to her parents. And you should get this story from her. And she left. And she experienced the island storm. Right.
She went right
into it.
So we didn't.
And we did not. We had, as I recall, about 90 mile islands. We've never really experienced, as long as I've been here, any bad storm as far as wind velocity. It has erosion from water, and most of those were from storms that were not even close to us.
But you never evacuated?
I have never evacuated. The closest we came was it Heloise or whatever her name was? Helene, what was that last one? Started with an H about 4 or 5 years ago when nobody could get on the island for 4 days. And John and I stayed.
And I survived Helena.
Yes. Right.
And we stayed, and the electricity went off, and of course the telephones went out, so we were totally isolated, saw absolutely nobody around us. And in the middle of all this, we did hear a truck going down the back street. We looked out the back window, and here was a big army truck. And I'm not supposed to tell this?
No. Oh, I wouldn't stop you from telling me. I think there's a cat under here.
And John says, they're coming to get us. They're coming to get us. So So sure enough, they did. They circled around, came to the front, and here comes out this man. Oh, it was the National Guard. In boots up to his hips, it's sloshing through the water, and knocks on the door, and he's got a little pamphlet in his hand. And I answered the door. My son was here with us, oldest son, Butch. And he says, "Are you the Van Alstyne Bridges?" And I said, "Yes." And I said, "Well, we had a report from somebody, relatives on the mainland that you wanted to evacuate." And I said, "Oh, no, no, we don't want to evacuate." "Well, the storm's getting very bad." He says, "This will be your last chance." I look around, I can't find John. And I...
Well, don't you want to ask another question now?
And I said, "No, we're not evacuating." Well, you know what happened? John says they weren't taking him. He was hiding in the closet. And it was they didn't take us. They're all dressed in their babushkas. They look like refugees, the last refugees of the war. I thought, well, if I go, I'm a little better style than this. But Vicki had called them and asked them to come get us. And,
hi, David.
Had asked them to come and get us. And that we were very old and senile. We were to leave whether we agreed to or not. We stayed. But no, we have not really experienced any bad storms. We've been very fortunate. The island has been very fortunate. And we've never left, but I would never tell anybody to stay if you were asked to stay.
Would you like to hear about the postmistress and her? This is really early. She told me we used to have her over, but then she said my sister and I were home when the wind, it got kind of windy, she said. Now this is, this is before 1920. Nobody knew what hurricanes were hardly here. And there were hardly any people here except she was the postmistress. What was her name?
Warwick.
Mr. Warwick. She said, she was telling me this on Thanksgiving Day. She said, "I want to tell you, we had a time. Sister and I saw the water coming in and it's getting dark outside and it's raining hard." And she said, "We wondered where the water was going to go. And we had no telephone, it was out. And they had a lamp, they lighted a lamp." And she said, "We had to finally climb up on a chair, each of us, and then we had to get on the table. The water was coming in more and more and more, and we hoped the oil would last in the lamp." And she said, "We sat there and we could hear the wind blowing. Terrible," she said. And she said, "We saw our clock. We could see our clock. It was 9 o'clock, pitch black. The wind was awful." And then she said, "We didn't know where we would go after the table." And we did have to get up on that table. And we
she lived about a block away from the beach,
only
too.
A block from the beach.
So that was probably the bad one that took the Longboat Key Bridge out or something.
Yes, it was a very bad one. But you see, the water would go over the island and into the what's over there? The other side.
My living room. My living room.
What's the water way over here?
The bay.
The bay. It comes from the Gulf. Go over. Don't laugh at me. I'm just a little loud. Anyway, Mrs. Wardick said, "Mama and I sat there and we couldn't see what was going on and the lamp was getting low, low, low." And she said, "It finally went out and we sat in the darkness." And she said, "We sat there for, it seemed like a year." And she said, "The roof still stayed on our house." And she said,
again, it was water erosion that we experienced more than the wind.
Yeah, it seemed like those storms were always worse at night. We couldn't really see what was.
And so many of them, almost all of them have hit at night.
I thought they were exciting.
So let me finish.
Oh, there's more?
Yes, of course.
Oh, we aren't finished.
She said when daylight came in little streaks, she said, the wind stopped. And then it was too quiet. I suppose it was in the middle of a storm.
Probably the eye.
The eye of the storm. And she said, Mama and I looked out the window when it got light enough, and the water had all disappeared into the bay. And that was our first sign of a hurricane.
We didn't have the forecasting back then.
No. Well, Daryl, now I know when you first arrived, you were in junior high school. You went into town to junior high school. Mm-hmm. And I guess you traveled across that old rickety wooden bridge.
Across that old rickety bridge. One school bus picked up everybody on the island. Then did not pick anybody up in Cortez, but they picked up students from about Paradise Bay Trailer Park all the way down to about 26th Street. And that was junior high and senior high. That was all junior high, senior high students on the island. So there were not too many of them. It was kind of neat going across that old bridge. It was very narrow, very rickety. The last few years, they would stop traffic going and coming so that we passed across the bridge all by ourselves because of the weight. And frequently the bridge got stuck in the open position and you had to wait for hours. Of course, that happens now, too.
Yeah, but tell them how the bridge used to open.
Well, the bridge didn't open like bridges do now. They, the bridge tender would come out with a crowbar and stick in the middle of the bridge, and then he would walk around and around, and the bridge would swing open. And it probably was very narrow between these posts, which is probably why they were being hit and jammed and couldn't get them closed. That poor man was stranded in the middle of that bridge, too. But one very cold, wintry, windy February day, we are waiting for the bus, waiting for the bridge to close, and it got hit by a barge, and it was jammed, and we sat there for hours, and we're going to be late for school, which was no great tragedy to us. We thought that was really quite neat. We had a very legitimate excuse to be late to school. And doggone if they didn't ferry us across a few at a time in a boat. We had a school bus waiting on the other side, and we got there about time for lunch. And but it was very exciting. And I used to ride with John when I met him. He used to ride on the dump truck, and he'd ride as close as he dared to the fisherman. And I'd reach out the window and knock their hats off as they went across.
Oh, you, terrible.
And you'd holler, got any bites? And they'd look at it and say, yeah, scratch it. Absolutely naughty.
Not me, I was just driving.
So when the new bridge opened, it took away a lot of our sporting.
Well, what about the time I towed you all around with that school bus?
On the school bus. Sometimes the school bus, and I think one time somebody put sand in the tank. I remember that.
Well, that wasn't me.
You pulled and pulled and pulled.
That never got going.
That one never got going. But the bus wouldn't start for some reason. And it parked. He parked, Mr. J, our bus driver, parked right alongside the home we were living in at that time, which was the Rosedale home.
That's where the sand came from.
I was always the first one on the school bus. So I always got the prime seat. And the bus wouldn't start. And I don't remember if we called you or you just happened to come by, but we got a hold of John in his big red dump truck with his chain. And he proceeds to pull us. And he was pulling a little faster than
Mr. J
thought was safe. Because he did have several children on the bus. I'm sure today you'd never be allowed to do anything But he pulled us in and pulled us halfway around the point. He would stop and let us make pickups. And that was just a dirt road. Mm-hmm. It was just a little two-lane dirt road around the point at that time. As a matter of fact, I'm not sure if it went all the way around the point.
That went all the way around, but it was dirt, yeah.
And he finally did get us started. But Mr. J still talks about that. You put a few gray hairs in his head.
Well, we had some fun with that old truck, though. We used to go to the movies with it, the drive-in. All the kids would lay down in the back, and we'd
high.
Yeah, and then we'd go to the drive up, and I had to get out and pay the man for two people, and we'd back up, get in the back row, because the other cars couldn't see anything. And everybody'd pop out. We'd have about maybe 20 kids in there. Mm-hmm. Everybody popping up to see the movie. We did that quite frequently. Mm-hmm. But they didn't mind, really, because we were good kids. They didn't start no trouble. Mm-hmm. I guess we bought a lot of that junk.
We led
junk
a very,
food.
Really, a very wholesome life here on this.
We used to have a lot of bonfires out on the beach.
A lot of picnics, even as young adults. Carolyn, I'm sure, remembers all our
great Wiener Rose
parties, the Wiener Rose and things. Which
it,
my
Carol.
Children never, and I always resented that. My children never got to have it.
Well, you really couldn't have it.
No, I couldn't.
They wouldn't let them have it. We had so much fun.
Well, I used to ride horseback up and down the mountain. Betty Lou had a horse, which she had in a fenced-in lot on White Avenue.
Now that was before my time, Carol.
Okay.
I know nothing about the horse.
We used to ride the horse up and down, and the sea turtles, which are now protected. They were a source of great fun. We used to take these, always take them home. We played. We never harmed them.
I can remember playing with the eggs with Huey and
how big? Oh no, these were the eggs. We played ping pong with them.
Was that the loggerhead?
The loggerhead.
Yeah, that's the one you had.
They were a huge turtle.
But no, this is just when they hatched out. When they hatched out, we take them a block away from the golf. Yeah. I'm kidding. We didn't play ping pong with them.
We did throw the eggs.
Honestly.
We threw the eggs.
Honestly.
We played a game throwing eggs.
Yeah, we did. We threw them around. Did we hurt them?
Oh, I don't remember.
Did they bounce?
Yeah, they do. They do. Yes.
But the little babies, we take a block away, and then it's almost like a compass. You put them down. They just head for the water, head for the golf.
There weren't any bright lights.
Probably not.
Yeah, but then it wasn't illegal to do that either. You could play with eggs and bounce them around. It wasn't illegal. Now you can't do that no more. It's another thing you can't do. Yeah, I bet they were good.
Turtle.
When we lived on White Avenue,
I can't stand those little. When I first came here, they had those little shells with those little things in them.
Coquinas,
and they said you made soup out of that. Wow, my mother tried that once. That was the most. Well, I don't even think the Indians would eat that.
Were they sandy?
Yeah.
You just didn't get down to the bottom. You let the soup settle.
What were you going to say?
I want to tell you about the blue crabs right offshore. We were living on White Avenue. You were with us all. I think all the young married people would go down with butterfly nets to the sand, to the beach, and on the Gulf side. And somebody had to carry the gunny sack. And the blue crabs would bite your legs if you were carrying them. You'd have little bites. Uh-huh. Anyway, we would come back with a half a gunny sack full of blue crabs, beautiful.
Yeah.
And we would go into my next door neighbor, put newspaper on the floor, put down these live things, have the water boiling. We had blue crabs coming out of our ears. We just sat on the floor and peeled them. And they were delicious.
Mm. That's when everything was so.
Maybe you can tell it better.
Or even the fish.
I don't even remember
scalloping. The first time I ever went stone crabbing, Richard Wiggins was here. He came to Rosa Church as the pastor. And he called me up one night and he said, John, would you like to go stone crabbing? Now, I lived here a long time before Richard got here, but I never stone crabbed. And I said, well, that sounds like fun. He said, okay. And went up to meet him, and he was on the beach with a stick. I thought, gosh, what are you going to do with a stick? And I didn't have no stick, but I had my bucket. And he kind of looked at me, and I kind of looked at him, and we started to look in the rocks. And he said, oh, there's one down here. And he took his stick and put it down there and pull it out, nothing. He put it down there and pull it out, nothing. And I said, well, Richard, get that stick out of the way. And I reached down in there, and I come out with the stone crab. And he said, well, you take one claw now. And I took a claw, put it in the bucket, put the stone crab back. Then we got to the next place, and Richard tries again with his stick. I said, get your stick out of here. And I reached down. I did this at least a half a dozen times and come out with a stone crab. Now remember, Richard's a preacher. And the next time I reached down in there, that stone crab bit me. I said, "The son of a," you know what I said. It bit me. And he started laughing. He said, "I thought you were an expert at getting those things. I just didn't know no better."
Well, what did he expect? The crab?
Yeah, after a while, after I wouldn't put my hand down on them more, he'd put a stick in there and wiggle it, and they would clamp onto the stick, and then you pull them out. And that's how you got them. But I was doing it with my hands. And he thought, he said, "I can't understand how John does that."
You just happened to be lucky the first few times.
I sure was.
Yeah, we used to take the kids in a lamp at nighttime. We got them with the spear.
Uh-huh. You know,
at nighttime, they'd like to come in about a bushel full.
Yeah, you used to be able to get a lot of them, and it was good eating. Oh, gosh.
Wonderful eating.
Anna, I see you brought some pictures
okay.
here. Would you tell us about this?
All right.
If you hold them up straight. I can maybe zoom in on them, okay?
I hope so. Now this was a picture that was taken by, I would say in the early 40s. It might have been before 40s, by Harold Smith, who was a photographer that time at in Braden Beach. Now this is, what you're looking at now is the end of Avenue, end of 31st Street and Avenue F.
Gad, just brushing my teeth. It was just horrible. Then we used to aerate. We had big bottles with wide necks, and you'd fill it up with water and let it air for a few days, and the sulfur would sort of evaporate out. And then we got our first little water company, which George was a part of. The sulfur disappeared, but you had so much iron and minerals and things that your white clothes were never white. After two washings, they were yellow, and it would set any stain.
Yes, uh-huh.
They were terrible. The big thing people would buy were the, if you were very wealthy, you'd buy the water softeners.
Water softeners, uh-huh.
But those are the two, well, perhaps the sewer, which has been in fairly recent years, because we have such a time with the septic tanks, and we get big hard rain, and you couldn't flush your toilets.
Oh,
everybody was having
rats come up in the sewer.
Well, that's the sewers.
They come in the sewers too.
Yeah.
Sewers.
But I don't know if I should tell. Should I tell that story about the mosquitoes again?
Yeah.
I think so.
When we were married in 1953, we were married on a Wednesday night. And everybody on the island knew one another. And John and I were well known, and it was a relief that you were well known. And inside joke, folks. Anyhow, the mosquitoes were very bad in 1953. This is before the mosquito control was really very effective. We had big trucks that would at night drive up and down your street. Here comes the mosquitoes. And everybody would, you know, wake everybody up. You'd hear this fogging machine come along. Well, we had contacted them, and they were going to spray Rosa Church, which is where we were getting married, and they were going to spray the patio at Blackburn's house, which is where we were having an outdoor reception. Well, they found the Blackburns and sprayed that first, and then as they're proceeding down Gulf Drive to Rosa Church, they passed the Baptist Church, and they thought, well, this must be where the wedding is. We must have misunderstood. There were some cars there, which were the people that were in prayer meeting an hour earlier than usual, so that they could all go to the Van Osten Bridge wedding. And the man just backs up his truck to the front doors, swings open the door, jumps in his truck, and guns it for all it's worth. Just fogged the inside of that church, and there was a very hasty amen. They had to adjourn prayer meeting early, and Rosa Church never did get sprayed, and all you heard, all the ceremony was slap. Everybody, that's really a different story. But the mosquitoes were terrible, and everybody had screen doors. They did not have air conditioning in those days. and before anybody would walk in, you'd meet them on the inside of the flint can. Wait a minute, all right, come in. And as they walked in, they got flinted, and you hope it got most of the mosquitoes. How many times you lay awake at night with mosquitoes buzzing around you?
Oh, I hate that.
And then the sand gnats would come in through the screens. So they had a product that you could paint or spray on there, which kept the sand gnats out. But it was very sticky. So after just a couple of days of a little wind, which remember they didn't have paved roads, they were just all sand roads, all the sand would be stuck to the screen. And you couldn't even see out of the screens.
It would get hot in the house.
Yeah, then you'd have to wash the screens off so you could see. But now the sand gnats got in, so you had to reapply it, so it was an endless battle. So many times the sand gnats really probably were worse than the mosquitoes, because the sand gnats you really couldn't defend yourself against.
I think they manufactured down there at Avenue E.
That always was bad for them, yeah.
Bad.
Yes, the area where I live, Amory and Holmes Beach, there it seemed to be still nights, and not every day that you were bothered with the sand gnats. But the mosquitoes were terrible. As soon as it got just at least a little bit dark, you had to get indoors.
Was there ever a time talking about that bridge, that the bridge was stuck and that you had to be taken across by a boat or...
Oh, yes.
The bus had to get on the
ferry. Yeah, did I start telling that story, how they opened it up?
No. You told that, but you didn't tell about how sometimes you couldn't get across the bridge.
Just that one time that we got ferried across, but I don't think it was ever out for any length.
No, you had all the kids had to be ferried across so they'd go to school, and another bus met you on the other end, and you got there in time to get your hot dog for lunch.
But
I think it was hot dogs and sausage or something for lunch that day.
We were never out. I don't think the bridge was ever out for any great length of time.
John, can you tell the one where the car hung over the new bridge, when it went up? And this car didn't see the bridge up.
I don't remember that.
I don't think that was
the Iron Bridge. I think that was the Skyway,
wasn't it? Yeah. No, it was here, was it?
Of course, our bridge didn't. The old bridge didn't go up.
No, I know. This other bridge.
Oh,
I remember that.
You don't remember that?
No, I thought that was over there in near Clearwater Beach.
No, it was here. It
was here?
Well, this has really been interesting and fun to sit out here and relive all the days past, and I think everyone that watches this will enjoy it very much.
We didn't have crime, did we?
No.
Oh, we had a jail.
Oh, yeah, we had a jail.
Didn't have any doors or windows.
Had no doors.
Nobody ever locked their door. Nobody took the keys out of their cars. Never. And it was not until we had children that were half grown and we went on vacation that we decided we should lock our doors because we'd be gone for 2 weeks and we had to change the locks on the house because we didn't know where the key was. And this was common. I think, most people were like
nobody
this.
Nobody locked up.
And I don't remember anybody ever.
It was
a very sheltered
spot. It was very, very sheltered. And I think Leon Stafford,
he was the chief of the fire. He was
the policeman, too? Yeah, he was the Holmes Beach beach marshal when Holmes Beach
he
was consolidated.
He used to have civil
arrest. He was the marshal. Mm-hmm. And John was the...
I ran against him
the last time that they... elected a city marshal. It was in the 70s.
And it was 74, wasn't it?
I was in college, so it had to be about 71, 72, and they revised or changed the...
Well, the only reason I ran
was
because there was...
Hold it. Stand by. Nope, sorry, it's recording. Go ahead.
This evening, we're with Michael Sato in Holmes Beach. And Michael is a fifth grade student at the Anna Maria School. He competed in the Manatee County History Fair. He was one of 500 contestants in the county, and he placed second. This is really exciting, Michael, if you got second. But would you show us your medal and your certificate? That's wonderful.
Here's the second place medal.
Yeah.
And here's my certificate.
Great. And what was the theme of your essay?
It was the history of Anna Maria Island.
And who did you interview?
Michelle.
And we have Chris with us tonight. And Michael is going to ask Chris the same questions that he asked her on his winning interview.
Please tell us your full name.
My full name is Christine Torgerson Shaw. I do want to say first that I'm very privileged to have the honor to be interviewed, and I was really excited about finding out that Michael had won this award. It was, at first, it was a dubious distinction because I got this message on my telephone recorder that Michael needed to interview somebody old for his oral history report about the history of Anna Maria. And I was really happy to say yes to the interview, but I hope I'm not the oldest person you could find around to interview, but thanks anyway, Michael. Go ahead.
How long have you lived on Anna Maria?
My family first came to Anna Maria in the late 40s, about 1947. My friends say that the beach washed up around my feet, but there were a few people here then. We actually made Anna Maria our permanent home in about 1950 when we bought the house, the castle house on Beach Avenue.
What was the biggest change?
Well, the biggest change is the traffic and the number of people that lived here. And when we first moved here, the intersection of Cortez Road and US 41 was nothing but a reptile farm where they had a big alligator pit and some snakes and things. Then we took a long, windy road, Cortez Road, out to Braden Cortez and over the wooden bridge, up a windy Gulf Drive, which was nothing but a sandy road, where Pete Renard's, then later Pete Renard's was built, and where that was, it was surrounded by mangroves. And we always thought it was fun to go there because we went and walked over a little footbridge, which is really where the Holmes Beach Basin is. We got telegrams from up north and heard from friends and family up north when they sent telegrams to the Western Union at the IGA, which of course is still there, but it was a much smaller store. And well, there's just a lot fewer people than there are now. When we stayed past the month of May. My dad was a ball player, so we were here until the ball season started after school was out. And we were the only family within about a 5-10 block area after the month of June.
What was Anna Maria School like?
Anna Maria School, when I started there at kindergarten, first grade, we had two quarters, which is now, you have the kindergarten quarter, well that was first, second, and kindergarten, first, second, third grade. Then we had fourth, fifth, and sixth on the next quarter. We had the nice cafeteria that you still have. We had a wonderful cook named Wanda Miller, and Wanda took very special pride in making us good and tasty lunches. She baked cakes once a month for everybody who had a birthday in that month. Lena Phelps was our principal, and she took a lot of time with each of the classes. She had was really interested in native birds, so she would take the classes out for bird walks, and we'd identify the different varieties of birds on the island. And she, I think, was very instrumental in my concern and love of the environment today, because she taught us to see things that you wouldn't normally see in the wildlife in the area. Also, her husband was a nurseryman, and so he came and would tell us about all the natural flowers and plants that we have on the island. It gave us very special insight. Elizabeth Moss, who recently retired as a city clerk in Anna Maria, was my fourth grade teacher. And we had a lot of fun with Mrs. Moss. And she was a very creative teacher, which all our teachers were. And we didn't have the structure that you have now where we had different skills we had to perform. They had a, you know, we had books that we had to learn from. And she said, now, you can confirm this with her, but she said we were her best class. So we learned everything we needed to learn in the morning, and in the afternoon we did square dancing, Spanish, crafts. We take our bird walks and do lots of fun for the rest of the afternoon.
What did you do for fun?
If we can go back to the school for a minute. I forgot to tell you about the great Halloween carnivals we had. And all, just like now, all the parents participated. And my dad, for instance, and his baseball pals set up the booths with the, different cans and stuff. We'd throw the baseball and knock the things over. And oh, you had the different art booths and all those things. But everybody, and Owen cake walk, and everybody participated. And it was kind of a community event. Our mothers were always helping out in the cafeteria during the school year, and they were helping out as gray ladies in the clinic. The other big event we had at the school was the Maypole Festival. And the sixth graders all got dressed up. The girls loved it because they could wear real pretty long party dresses. The boys did not like getting dressed up at all, but they had to get dressed up and wear little ties and things. And we all did the Maypole dance, and the parents would come and watch us. And that was a lot of fun for us, at least. And they'd crown a queen of the sixth grade and a king for the sixth grade.
What did you do for fun?
For fun, we spent our time on the beach, in boats, we went fishing. We were always water skiing right through the time I was in high school. We were always in a boat. My first boat was built by Humbug Cobb, and actually it was a boat for my brother and I, and Hugh Holmes shared it too. And it was a sailing dinghy. And the first thing my brother did was get rid of the sail. Well, they sailed it, I guess, for a couple of weeks. And if you ask Hugh Holmes, they have home movies of my brother Andy and Hugh sailing the boat up the bayou, down the bayou, up the bayou, down the bayou. But they needed to go a little faster, so out came the sail, and we put a little three-horse engine on it and went speeding all through the bayous and up and down the canals. And one of our favorite things to do at low tide was to take the boat and go speeding under the docks at the Bayou Marina, which is now Galati's. We also loved the water skiing because the canal seat were just being dug out and there weren't any houses on the canals, but it was like just the mangrove shore. So you could really get down in the canals where there was no wind and there was no ripples at all, so it's real smooth and you can do great skiing. We skied on everything, I think even on palm fronds, but we're always in the water. We did a lot of fishing. Like my brother and his friends would go out to the city pier and set shark lines. They'd spend the night on the pier. We'd get the little dinghies and flat boats and go out gigging flounder, which you can't do now. When I was little, I remember going with my dad and his friend, my mom, and other people. My mom, sometimes she went with us, but she would stay back at the house and they'd get dinner ready and everything, and we'd go out or just they'd stay back, but dad and his friends would take the kids and we'd go stone crabbing, and all we'd have to do was just walk out in the water and they'd carry the lanterns and somebody else would have nets. And one of our best spots was down where Coquina Beach is now, because that was all Mangrove Island. So we could just walk back in there and pick the crabs up. They were seemed to be everywhere. But everything we did had to do with being in the water or on the water, boating and fishing. And there was just a lot to do. The same kind of things you have to use your imagination. The same kind of things you have. I mean, the golf is still here and the beach is still here. We also had lots of pets. You know, we had a pet raccoon. And he would walk on the beach with me at night with my bulldog, my mom, and my raccoon, and the bulldog, and the cat. We'd all walk on the beach at night. Sometimes, one time I had collected gopher turtles with my brother. We had up to 17 gopher turtles in the backyard till my mother put an end to that. I can't imagine why. there was a lot of exploring, you know, a lot of neat jungles and all to, you know, make forts in and ride a bike around. So also we had the Island Teen Club, our youth center, which now is the community center. And when I first started going there, there was just the one-room schoolhouse, and Mrs. Hawkins would get a movie on Saturday night, and we'd pay a quarter or something like that to go in, and she'd run the movies. Because, of course, most of us would just talk and laugh and fool around, but we had candy bars and Cokes, and that was a big treat for us. Later on, our parents all got together and they built the community center, you know, made the bigger building so we could have dances and bands would, you know, we'd get a local band or they'd play records and things like that. Also, our dads got together and built the ball field, which is now the Spaniel Hutchinson Field. As families, we would get together with everybody and go down to the beach and have big bonfires and cook the fish and just have a lot of cookouts that way. That was always fun. My dad and mom seemed to have they'd invite the baseball team out to the island, and they'd have everybody over for fish and crab and stuff like that. We always had to have those parties, though, the night before the garbage men came, because you couldn't wait a day, because the raccoons would have it all over the street. It was just really something. So that's the kind of lifestyle we had then.
Was there really an airport?
Yes, there was really an airport. And the airport was at the location of the Island Library. And there was a windsock. And when you flew in, you'd have to buzz the airport and find out which way the windsock was blowing. If it was going one way, you came in and you'd touch down near where the tennis courts are. And then you'd land and you'd have to hope the brakes would hold so you wouldn't go in the basin by Pete Renard's. If it was going the other way, then you came in, and if it was high tide, you got the tires wet. Now, my dad would fly into the Tampa airport because that's the closest place that the airplanes came in. Then he would rent a puddle jumper, which is one of those little planes, and they'd fly down, and he'd just buzz the house, you know, go around my house. And so my mom, who was usually sunbathing up in the tower there, would say, "Oh, your dad's home," and we'd get in the car and we'd race down to the airport. Now, if it was late at night and she'd hear that plane go around, we'd go down there and call our neighbors, and they would all put their car lights shining out on the airstrip so we could land with and know where the airstrip was.
What do you miss the most of the old days?
I don't miss the mosquitoes. I have to say that I don't miss the mosquitoes. When I was little, now they talk about the good old days, and it was wonderful growing up on Anna Maria and having so much freedom and being in the water. But I will tell you that when I left my house to take that great afternoon swim to cool off in the afternoon, I would have to hit that screen door, wrap a towel around me, run all the way to the beach, dive in the water, and the mosquitoes were just swarming. So I don't miss them at all.
How was the fishing back then?
The fishing was great. You could always throw a line in, catch a flounder, catch a, you know, a little trout. We had, as I said, we had a lot of the gigging where you could go out and gig flounder at night. And shark fishing was fun, but you didn't have anything to eat when you were done.
Did you have air conditioning?
We had no air conditioning. We didn't even hardly have heating. We had a fireplace and we had a big gas heater in our house. When it started getting warm in the month of May, we all slept out on a sleeping porch in our house where we could hear the Gulf at night. And I still like to go to sleep at night trying to listen to the Gulf to see if I can hear it on the quiet nights. But we had no air. The school wasn't even air conditioned. She just didn't seem to be bothered by not having air conditioning when you don't have to go in and out of it all the time. It doesn't seem to be as bad and or as hot, and you just would cool off with that nice afternoon swim.
Were there many churches?
There were a few churches out here. We had St. Bernard's, and we had the Gloria Dei Lutheran and the Rosary Church. When I first started going to Gloria Dei, we met down at the Annie Silver Community Hall in Bradenton Beach. And then later they built the beautiful sanctuary at 66th Street. All of the churches, the kids who went to all the different faiths, the different churches on the island, our youth group was still centered around the Rosary Church. And we had retreats and we had cookouts and beach parties for the Rosary Church. So it didn't matter what church you belonged to, you still went to the Rosary Youth Group and the Community Center. We all did the same thing. We went to the Community Center together, we go to Rosary Church together, but it was the same gang, just in different spots.
Was there an island doctor?
Oh yes, and the island doctor was Ed Huth, who just recently celebrated his 85th birthday. My mother worked for the doctor, for the island doctor, for 15 years. After Dr. Huth, Dr. Deem, and Dr. Holsworth started working there. And it's where Dr. Pelham is now. In those days, the doctor looked at tonsils and took care of your cold and your flu and that sort of thing, but also he took out stingray barbs and took care of rattlesnake bites. You see, when we came back after our being gone for the summer and my dad did the first mowing on our yard, we would get maybe 3 or 4 rattlesnakes out of our yard. So, I mean, we had kind of a different, the yard, we had a lot more little animals around that you could get hurt with, but Dr. Huth did everything, even deliver a few babies.
Was there a fire department?
Yes, there was a fire department, and that was really important to us then, because if you think about the island being just like all, you know the jungle down near Holmes Boulevard, where you kids call it the jungle at about Holmes, now they have a new development there, but there's Holmes Boulevard and about 65th Street, where they had just solid trees and everything. Well, the whole island would be covered with the old palmetto, palms and dry palms, so in the spring when it would get real dry, if there ever started a fire, we had to get that fire out as soon as possible. Now my brother was kind of, he could get into trouble every now and then. And Andy was down at the gully, which is the dip you find at the end of Beach Avenue, where it's a little bit, it goes down a little bit, it's a little marshy before you get to the beach. Well, Andy was down there. We had a little wooden bridge that went over that gully to get to the beach. Andy was down there playing with matches, which he shouldn't have been doing. All of a sudden, he came running up, Patty Hutchinson, the gully's on fire. Well, everybody has to get together to get that fire out because there's no telling how far that would spread. Also, the jungle that went from our castle house to Gulf Drive, that was all jungle. We had forts in there, we had little paths that went through there. Andy again, playing with matches, starts the fire. Well, here come the fire trucks. Everybody got together. It was strictly volunteer. I remember one time when we were all swimming at the 75th Street Beach, which is where our friends the Hutchinsons live, and my dad was watching all of the kids. Well, there went the fire siren. All the cars were gone. My mom had her car, Patsy had the other car, Patsy Hutchinson. My dad got on my bike and rode my bike to the fire in order to help him. But everybody helped to get those out because if the wind was blowing, you catch those dry palm fronds and pretty soon we could all be in a lot of trouble. But it was the same, a real community, real volunteer, and everybody was really I was serious about. Their job was a volunteer in the fire department.
Anything else you'd like to say about life on Anna Maria?
Well, there's a lot to think about as we've had so many changes. But as things have changed, I think that the thing that I loved most about the island growing up is still here. And a few years ago, I was watching my daughter Anna, who's now 13, feeding the seagulls out in the low tide in the bay. And she had a bucket. She had picked up some crabs and some little shells, and then she was out there feeding the gulls. And, you know, those were the things that I enjoyed when I was growing up. And I know we have a lot more people and a lot more traffic and a lot more houses here. But the things that I loved about Anna Maria, we can still enjoy, and our children can still enjoy. And I think that's what's very special about this community.
This is Michael Sato signing off.
Michael, that was wonderful. You make a very, very good interview.
Oh, I thought he did a great job. And he got some real details out of me.
Yes, you did wonderful too. Thank you both so much for being with us and making our historical data more interesting. Thanks again. Signing off.